Simon & Schuster Audio presents Unholy Alliance, the agenda Iran, Russia, and jihadists share for conquering the world. Written by Jay Sekulow. Read by the author. This program contains a PDF of appendices.
Preface. This book is the second in a series that began with the number one New York Times bestseller, Rise of ISIS, published with our Oxford Center for the Study of Law and Public Policy. Much of the research for this book took place during my summers at the University of Oxford at the historic and world-renowned Bodleian Library. 3 years ago, I undertook an extensive study of the former Prime Minister of Great Britain, Benjamin Disraeli. I was privileged to have access to his private papers. Interestingly, Disraeli faced challenges eerily similar to the ones addressed in this book. During Disraeli's time, Russia caused much commotion throughout Europe and especially with Turkey. Not much has changed in the ensuing 150 years. Disraeli famously said, "Questions between Russia and England are not questions that can be settled by arbitration. They are questions in which power is involved, and power can only be met by power. Questions of this kind can only be settled by force. I do not mean necessarily by war. I mean by diplomacy or war, because in my opinion, diplomacy is force without violence." The next year at the University of Oxford, I studied former British Prime Minister Winston Churchill, who prophetically warned unsuccessful interventions in the affairs of another country is generally agreed to be a mistake. Churchill was correct, and we should heed his admonition even today. Last year, I did a comprehensive study of T.E. Lawrence, Lawrence of Arabia. Lawrence played a pivotal role in the development of the modern Arab world. He was both pro-Arab and a Zionist. Unlike today, during this time period, this was not a contradiction. I read the entirety of Lawrence's tome, Seven Pillars of Wisdom, as well as his personal letters. Colonel Lawrence had a comprehensive and personal relation with the emerging Arab political leaders during World War I. He also encountered the Persians, the Iranians of today. He made an interesting and important observation regarding their unique view of Islam. Lawrence observed that the Shia Mohammedans from Persia were surly and fanatical, refusing to eat or drink with infidels, holding the Sunni as bad as Christians, following only their own priests and notables. Each of these three leaders provides valuable insight into the intrigue that is the Middle East today, because the lessons they learned from their leadership in their eras can instruct us on the challenges we face in our own time. A new alliance has developed in the last few years that has created what I call an unholy alliance. History often repeats itself. We no longer have the luxury of simply letting history unfold. We must change the course of events, rewriting the history if needed to preserve our constitutional republic. In this volume, I discuss and analyze the history and suggest a path of engagement to end what is the latest in a history-spanning line of attempts to export Sharia law and radical jihad around the world. We will win. We must win. We have no option. Chapter 1. Exporting Terrorism. Every day, every single day, we turn on the news, check our phones, or start our computers, and we see the horrific headlines. Tragically, they become commonplace now. We expect them. Terrorists burn entire villages to the ground with the children's wailing heard miles away. Christian men are forced to kneel above explosives that are detonated by jihadists. Crucifixions, beheadings, Christians are buried alive. Missionaries' sons and daughters are slaughtered. Women are sold into sex slavery. The younger the girl, the higher the price. Radical Islamic terrorists even distribute pamphlets explaining how Islamic law does not forbid the rape of young girls. It breaks our hearts. It makes our stomachs churn. We crave justice. But the slaughter of Christians and other religious minorities and desecration of these religions' heritages aren't restricted to villages in the middle of nowhere. Nor has radical Islam stopped at cities in Iraq and Syria. The entire world is at war with radical Islam, whether President Barack Obama and progressives in the ivory towers of academia and the powerful halls of our federal government are willing to admit it or not. One thing is certain, radical Islam is at war with us. Terrorist attacks are now a reality for everyone around the world. No one is safe. No city, town, or village is out of the reach of the radical jihadists. No one and no place is terrorist-proof. On November 13, 2015, the world was shocked by several coordinated attacks in Paris, France. Two explosions erupted outside a stadium filled with fans enjoying a soccer game. At the exact same time, gunmen armed with assault rifles engaged in shooting sprees at four different locations in Paris, and a suicide bomber detonated a bomb inside a restaurant. Altogether, 130 people were killed in a single hour, and hundreds more were injured. Daesh, more commonly known as the Islamic State of Iraq and Syria, or ISIS, claimed credit for the massacre. I still remember watching the news, glued to the TV, talking with the American Center for Law and Justice's affiliate offices in Europe and around the world. When would the next attack happen? How many more would die? I prayed for the victims, the families, and the law enforcement and military officials working to find the evil men and women targeting all of us. The Paris attacks weren't the beginning, and they certainly would not be the end. In modern history, the norm has been for terror cells to disperse after a major attack like Paris. The surviving jihadists normally scatter around the world and the cell is done. But tragically and unfortunately, after Paris, the ISIS cell in Europe stayed alive and carried out another large-scale attack in Brussels. This network of ISIS-linked cells in Europe included many jihadists who had spent time fighting in Syria. Interviews and confidential court documents seen by the Wall Street Journal defined the fugitives as part of an extensive web of young men who developed a deep hatred of the West after embracing radical Islam at the underground mosques and clandestine meetings in Molenbeek, a heavily Muslim-populated district in the heart of Brussels. They have since become central to Islamic State's plans to strike the West, according to investigators who suspect the Brussels network is behind the movement of battle-hardened operatives from Syria to Europe. When this cell struck again on March 22, 2016, they attacked the ticketing and baggage area of the Brussels airport and one of the main subway stations, resulting in the death of at least 35 people, including three Americans. More than 300 others were injured. On June 28, 2016, jihadists using a similar strategy attacked Istanbul's airport in Turkey, killing 41 and injuring more than 230. And once again in Europe, on July 14, 2016, as Bastille Day celebrations commenced in Nice, France, a jihadist drove a large truck down a street, leaving at least 84 dead and more than 200 injured. Another attack could strike the heart of Europe at any moment. Meanwhile, miles of oceans aren't enough to keep the United States safe from jihadists. In fact, only a month after the Paris attacks, in the United States, Tashfeen Malik and her husband, Saeed Rizwan Farouk, opened fire on colleagues with whom Saeed had worked. The attack took place during a holiday party being held at a county convention center in San Bernardino, California. In fact, just weeks before the terrorist attack, Saeed's co-workers had thrown a baby shower for them. This couple killed the very people who had celebrated the birth of their child. This is beyond horrific. Again, as the bad news broke, I suspected jihad had once again come to our homeland. Sure enough, the FBI officially classified the massacre as a terrorist attack. On the day of the shooting, Tashfeen Malik posted on her Facebook page a pledge of allegiance to ISIS. In the early morning hours of June 12, 2016, at a nightclub in Orlando, Florida, Omar Mir Sadiq Mateen, an American citizen born to Afghan parents, carried out the largest terrorist attack on U.S. soil since 9/11, slaughtering at least 49 of our fellow Americans and injuring dozens more. He called 911 during the attack and pledged allegiance to ISIS. Once again, terrorism had struck our shores. And sadly, reports show that Mateen had been under FBI investigation numerous times previously and had been cleared. But not all terrorist attacks on America get the same news coverage. Whenever possible, politicians work with the media to downplay terrorist attacks by ignoring their Islamic causes, calling them instead routine crimes. This most recently happened in early January 2016, when a gunman ambushed a police officer in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, firing multiple close-range shots into his patrol car. While in custody, the gunman openly confessed to being a follower of Allah, committing the act in the name of Islam, and pledged allegiance to ISIS. The same thing happened immediately after a terrorist openly fired on military recruiting offices in Chattanooga, Tennessee, in July 2015. In both of these cases, the media and many politicians went out of their way to avoid talking about possible Islamist connections, including disregarding, until it was unavoidable, the ties to radicals or the audible pledges to Allah. Sadly, while media reports of tragic attacks in Paris, San Bernardino, and Brussels remind us of the threat we face, it's impossible to comprehend just how often jihadists shed innocent blood and butcher men, women, and children around the world. On November 12, 2015, two suicide bombers killed 43 people in the streets of Beirut, Lebanon, and injured at least 239 others. One surviving attacker claimed to have been working for ISIS, and an online statement purporting to be from the organization claimed responsibility. On January 12, 2016, a suicide bomber blew himself up in Istanbul, Turkey, choosing to attack an area frequented by tourists and filled with innocent families. 10 people died in the attack and 15 others were injured. Although no terror group officially claimed responsibility, the Turkish government identified the bomber as Syrian and believed that ISIS committed the attack. This is just a small sampling of the alarming attacks that have occurred around the world. As this sample suggests, ISIS has been establishing a name for itself as a primary perpetrator of Islamic terrorism globally, reaching even to American soil. But what is ISIS, and perhaps more important, what is the cause or inspiration that has led to its development? Is ISIS truly the primary terror threat in the world today, or is it simply the most visible face of a deeper problem, a single sprout growing from a much more ominous and extensive root system? The many faces of terror. As we know, ISIS is not the only group responsible for acts of terrorism around the world. Many of the terrorist groups, both new and old, join ISIS by pledging fidelity to its caliphate, or at the very least, expressing similar goals: to conquer the world by destroying anyone who refuses to bow to its radical ideology and anything that threatens its radical apocalyptic worldview. The groups use many different names and consist of many different nationalities, yet they are inspired by the same religious zeal. They are known as Boko Haram in Nigeria and other African countries, the Al-Nusra Front in Syria, Hamas in Palestine, Hezbollah in Lebanon, the Taliban in Afghanistan, and Al-Qaeda throughout the world. On December 16, 2014, 7 Taliban militants attacked a school in Peshawar, Pakistan, killing at least 145 people, the vast majority of whom were children between the ages of 12 and 16. Hamas constantly carries out its campaign of terror against Israel and Jewish people everywhere. For decades, Hamas has indiscriminately and deliberately fired thousands of rockets at Israeli civilians. In 2014, Palestinian terrorists, as well as civilians, started a stabbing campaign that continues today against innocent Jewish men, women, and children, killing and wounding scores of Israelis. So what are these terrorist goals? Who is their primary target? The vast majority of the targets are Western, with attacks in Europe and the United States being the unholy grail for these jihadists. Whether we are willing to admit it or even realize it, they are determined to eliminate us. No amount of posturing or political correctness will make this any less true. If we are to stop this terrible pattern of death and terror, we must understand the underlying motivation that has galvanized groups such as ISIS and spurred them into action. We must diagnose the disease before we can truly eradicate the symptoms. The historical roots of terror. So how did we get here? Where did ISIS come from? The origin and motivating forces of ISIS, the latest radical Islamic effort to establish a worldwide caliphate, is tied directly to the tumultuous situation in Iraq and Syria in particular, and the Middle East in general. Understanding it requires a foundational knowledge of modern history. Prior to World War II,
we hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.